talking about a pilgrim. He doesn't give money because of altar. He doesn't give sacrifice because of altar.
He's serving the Lord
because he knows he's not of this world. He's just passing through. Whatever he has, let him use it to serve the Lord, to pick up things in heaven, to lay up treasures in heaven. That is the life of a pilgrim.
It's been said, if you want to get married, sow a seed. But God has sent Apostle Takim to tell us, if you want to get married, come into my manifest presence.
It's been said, if things are not okay with you, it's your foundation that is responsible, or some altars in your village. But God has sent his teaching prophet to tell us, if things are not okay with you, it is the foundation of the Lord that is missing in your life. The Cry of the Spirit Ministries in Nairobi presents the Prophetic and Apostolic Teaching Ministry of Richard E. S. Takim. Now, follow us to the sanctuary.
All these things the apostle says is coming for your village. Which village? There is no oppression that comes from the village. Write it, buddy. There is no oppression that comes from the village. Spare your villages. All oppression comes from the flesh. Whenever you see unquenchable works of darkness, the flesh is fueling it, and Satan is blindfolding you not to see it. I know what I'm saying will not make sense to everybody. I repeat, whenever you see unquenchable problems, Satan is not the one fueling, your flesh is fueling it. The fuel of persistent adversity is the flesh, not the devil. Satan is not as strong as you think. I've said it over and over. Listen, come out in Jesus' name. It's enough. Be healed. It's enough. You are free. It's enough. That is if a demon is responsible. But if it is you, you are free. Come out. Be healed. Be delivered. Prosper. Until the pastor will get tired. A pastor who don't know, who say, there's an altar in your life. An altar is defying my prayer. Pastor, altar defy your prayer. The young prophet went to Judah and he prophesied against the altars of Balaam and they broke instantly. Pastor, grow up. Even you, your brain is wrapped. If we preachers, we start preaching the right gospel, which is walk away from the flesh, there'll be no deliverance services. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying here? So Ananias came to church and died for nothing. A place where they pick deliverance, he came and picked death. Only the flesh can make you pick death where you're supposed to pick deliverance. Only the flesh can make you pick offense where you're supposed to pick miracle. Only the flesh can make you pick death where you need to pick deliverance. Only the flesh can make you pick offense where you need to pick miracles. That is why in the presence of God, not everybody gets blessed because some are walking in the flesh. And after they have walked in the flesh and nothing is happening, they blame the pastor. They blame the church. Number four, decision. Decision not to walk in the flesh. Is someone hearing me? Let me give you decision number five. How many of you are going to decide against the flesh from today? Whenever you identify it, shoot it down. Whenever it's springing up in your heart, do what? Take it out. I say, you have had me all my life, but from today, no more. Is somebody hearing me? Ananias died for nothing because of that. Number five, decision to live the life of a pilgrim while you are here in this world. While you are in your body. Put it that way. Decision to live a life of a pilgrim. In another word, decision for pilgrimage. Who is a pilgrim? Write this down. A pilgrim is a person who is out of his own country in a foreign land. Full stop. A pilgrim is a person who is out of his own country in a foreign land. Full stop. He does not intend, continue writing, to put down roots there, but is heading elsewhere towards a definite goal or destination. He does not intend to put down roots there, but is heading elsewhere towards a definite goal or destination. That's a pilgrim for you. He does not intend to put down roots there, but is heading elsewhere towards a definite goal or destination. That's where pilgrimage is. I have searched my Bible. I have not seen a pilgrim struggle with breaches. No. Is someone hearing me? No pilgrim in God's kingdom struggled with breaches. No. So the decision to be a pilgrim on earth delivers for breaches, heal breaches. In fact, you cannot decide not to walk in the flesh if you have not decided to be a pilgrim. You understand what I'm saying? They are interconnected. Decision to be a pilgrim will reinforce other decisions that you have made in Christ. It's so sad that our church generation does not hear this kind of gospel. This is what every preacher in Christ is supposed to be telling people. We are pilgrims on earth. Our Savior said, you are not of this world. It wasn't a speech. It was an intentional revelation to create a culture for living for you and I. Everybody who try to take root in this earth will end up creating breaches in their lives. Everybody will try to take root, because one of the characteristics of a pilgrim is he does not intend to put down roots. He does not intend to take root where he is, because he is passing through. It was the revelation of pilgrimage that made me to resist certain things many years ago that I was being asked to do, even in the families. I said, no, I won't do that. One of the highest revelations that hit my mind happened in 1997 when God said to me, spend your days as you should. And I'm preaching in 1998, and I preached here in Kenya also. Spend your days as you should. That's what the Lord said to me. Spend your days as you should. Don't build a house to make a name. Build a house when it becomes part of the eternal purpose for your life. To execute my assignment for your life. Don't acquire things to make a name. Are you understanding me? That is why I've been in ministry for over 20 years before I bought a car. Over the car I bought is now up to 3 years old. Okay, I've been in ministry for 31 years. The car I have now is not up to three years old. So remove 3 from 31. How many years have I been in ministry? I told you in 1999, somebody told my younger sister that your brother is not called of God because he doesn't have a car. Whoever God calls, God gives a car to. And I didn't blame the girl because she heard a false gospel and believed it. Some of you were there in the church when I came to Kenya, and the pastors here in Kenya were insulting me that I don't have a car. One even insulted me that he's going to send a car to me. Go and tell Takim that I want to give him one car. Those are preachers who are not part of the kingdom. They don't know why we are preaching. The life of a pilgrim, you don't acquire things to make a name. Why did God bring Babylon down? Because they wanted to make a name for themselves. When a Christian lives a life to make a name for himself, he begins to go down. When you acquire something for carnal reasons, you are not a pilgrim. I'm not saying we should be poor. If you are buying a private jet, why? If you are building a house, why? If you are acquiring anything on earth, why? If the reason is rooted in you, you are not a pilgrim. This decision is a product of revelation. This kind of decision. Is someone hearing me? Songs like, I am running a race to meet my Redeemer. I am running a race to meet my Redeemer. Heavenly race, heavenly race, heavenly race to meet my Redeemer. Are not just melodies. They are lifestyles. There are songs that are lifestyles. You sing like a melody. If it's not a lifestyle to you, you are just singing a melody. If it's a lifestyle to you, it sends vibration in your life, in your body, while you are singing it. If it's a lifestyle to you. Are you a pilgrim? If the answer is no, then your life will be full of breaches. Because you will try to get all you can. You can all you get. So in a bid to get all you can and can all you get, you lie, you deceive, you create breaches. The love of money is not in the heart of a pilgrim. The desire for the things of this world is not in the heart of a pilgrim. Listen, this one you may not like it. Marriage is not in the heart of a pilgrim. God brings it. Adam was not thinking about marriage. You remember? It was God that said, it's not good for you to be alone. A pilgrim does not spend day and night. Father, if I'm your God, if you are my God, give me a husband. If you are my God, give me a husband. You see, you are not a pilgrim. You are a puppet. You are not a pilgrim. You are a puppet of your own carnal desires. A pilgrim is living a life that does not take root on earth. And God will meet the pilgrim and say, it's not good for you to be alone. Take a husband, take a wife. And God will give you a husband or a wife who is also a pilgrim. Pilgrim marries pilgrims. And they live their life differently. That is why you see there is no conflict that cannot be solved, because this world is not yours. Most conflict in marriages is because hearts are not sold out to God. Hearts are sold out to the things of this world. Have you made a decision to be a pilgrim? If you have not made, then your bridges cannot be healed. Let me show you a scripture. Psalm 89. The pilgrims does not take root. Lives as a foreigner. Have intention not to take root. I repeat that one deliberately. Because of a definite destination. You can tell believers we are not pilgrims yet. In fact, out of every 10 believers today, maybe 9.5 are not pilgrims. Out of every 10 pastors today, 9.5 are not pilgrims. The way we do our ministries, the way we lead our ministry, we are not pilgrims at all. Can I tell you something? I said this many years ago. No matter how much God bless the crowd of the Spirit, I will never build a church building that can sit more than 15,000 people. I will never attempt it, because I'm not a permanent resident of this world. And I'm not gathering crowds that will give me tithe and offering. I've told you before that a pastor cannot pastor effectively more than at least 10,000 people. I'm talking about effective pastoring. Oh, this massive building, 1 million. Those guys are not pastors. They are evangelists. They are gathering crowd. It's a crowd. It's not a church. It's a crowd of miracle seekers. A church is not a crowd of miracle seekers. A church is a people who are heavily minded. It's not a crowd. If I'm gathering a crowd of miracle seekers in Kenya, we'll get a land anywhere and build 1 million capacity seater. 1 million capacity, because it's crowd. It's a crowd pulling and money making ministry. Why did Jesus pick only 500? You mean Jesus would not have picked 5 million? Only 500. Out of the 500, he extracted 70. Out of the 70, he extracted 12. Out of the 12, he extracted 3. And made them pillars for the first 100 years of the church. Jesus is not a Babylonian. He does not build a tower that will reach to the sky to make a name for himself. All this large building they are building is to make a name for themselves. It's not the Great Commission. The Great Commission is not executed by gathering crowd. The Great Commission is executed by forming Christ in people. By forming Christ in people, crowd gathering is a money-making system. What I've just said today, I've said it in the 90s, I said it when we crossed here 2000, that is my life, because we are not taking root in this world. We are not going to waste resources on things that fire is coming to destroy. 2 Peter chapter 3, he said the world will be consumed by fire. A pilgrim knows what is ahead. A pilgrim lives in time from the standpoint of eternity. A pilgrim lives in time from the standpoint of eternity. People in this world don't understand pilgrimage. They would think that you are stupid. They would think that you are crazy. They would think that you are mad. But there is something you have seen that is approaching with nobody seeing. And you are culturing your life accordingly. And that thing must surely come to pass. It is called judgment, and the world will be refurbished, and there will be a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Then I can build, because you will not be the one building. It's the Lord that will build. Pilgrimage is the missing ingredient in the life of many. Pilgrimage. It's not there. We just want to remain in this world. And yet people die every day. You want to remain and yet you are not remaining. Is it not stupid? You want to remain and yet you are not remaining. Don't you know that that desire to take root is preventing you from preparing yourself? Can I submit to you? The greatest preparation in life is not the preparation to live on earth. It's the preparation to depart from the earth. Listen, 2 days ago, I said to myself, I was just studying. I said to myself, if I get to the end of my life, I have fought a good fight, I've run the race, and get to the end of my days, I know if I get very old, I could be alone in that room. Because the way you become so old, people don't want to stay with you. I said to myself, I could be alone in that room. I could just be on that bed, waiting. And when death comes, I will look at death in the face. I say, I have waited for you all my life. That's what I said 2 days ago. I will look at death in the face. I said, I have waited for you all my life. Thank you for coming. Now can we move? Now can we move? I have waited for you all my life. I gave my life to Christ years ago. I'm waiting for you. I preach every day waiting for you. I prepare people waiting for you. I prepare myself waiting for you. I fast and pray waiting for you. I separate myself from sin and wickedness waiting for you. I have been waiting all my life. I have been waiting for you all my life. That is why I'm a Christian. That is why I'm following the Lord. I don't want to die in sin. I want to die prepared for the next life. Are you understanding me? I gave my life to Christ because I know my life is temporal. One day I will run this race. I will breathe my last. When I come out of my body, where will be my destination? So I've been waiting for you all my life. That's what I said. I will look at death in the face and say, I've been waiting for you all my life. Thank you for coming. Can we go? For us in Christ, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. That's why you don't threaten us with death. No, you don't. My life is not in the mouth of people or in their wishes. My life is in the hands of the Lord. He determined how many times I'm to breathe on earth. Nobody can determine that. I've told you when we were speaking about immortality. You remember? Why are you alive? You think it is to take root in this world. Check people who are trying to take root. Are they still alive? If we go into history, we know men like Adolf Hitler that try to take root. Even before them, ancient kingdoms and empires have tried to take root on it. They spread like deities. They kill who they can kill. They take away the life of whoever they can take away. They have authority to make the poor poor or make them rich. And they thought they would be immortals. But one day, death came and they were uprooted. From every year, every age, from age to age, season to season, God have let man know, you are not forever. And yet man have not gotten the message. We are still taking root in an earth that has been cursed. And God is saying, I am refurbishing this earth. The earth I have given
gave it to the children of men, but not this one. This one I will not allow anyone to take root.
And yet you think you are living in a realm where you can take root. You only end up not being prepared for the inevitable. You will end up not being prepared for the inevitable. The life of a pilgrimage does not take root, lives as a foreigner, has a strong intention not to take root, and because he have a definite goal, he had a definite destination. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So he doesn't behave like the rich fool who gathered all the wealth and now say, my soul, rise up and eat. No. He looked for a city which had foundations, which maker and builder is God. A pilgrim is different from an average Christian.